really, obviously, I want to, first of all, add my welcome to you all this evening, friends, colleagues, esteemed visitors. It really is going to be a very special event. I mean, it's certainly something that Rob has never done before, and we've certainly not. We've learned a lot in the process of staging the event, and I think you're actually really going to see something very, very special, and I know you are. I've been asked, my first job is housekeeping, so to tell you that the, you know, should there be a fire, the exit is here. If you go through this door as well, should need be, there are toilets. Please do check that your mobile phones are switched off. Please, no photography during the performance. Obviously, it's very off-putting. And as you know, there, I think most of you, that there will be a little reception afterwards, there'll be an opportunity for everyone to talk, and you know, you're very welcome to stay on for that. I really need to record my personal thanks to everyone involved in this. And I think almost everyone in the School of Education has played some part in this event at some stage over the past year, particularly Carmel and Marita, my colleagues in the Arts and Education Research Grouping. Yes, we have put a lot of work into it. The admin staff in the school have been fantastic. They always are, of course, but putting on this event today really is a splendid effort again, and Paula, Valerie, Kira, Danielle, Liz, everyone I know has played a part, and colleagues as well I know have made space for us and have wished as well, so I really do offer my sincere thanks to all of those. Where did this event begin? Where did it come from? I was asking myself in preparing this. Maybe 1 year ago. 1 year ago was when I phoned up Donald Duffy, who was Ralph's manager at the time, and I'm really, really pleased that Donard is here this evening to see the fruition. I don't know where you are, Donard. I'm really delighted that he's here this evening, because really, over a phone in a back room in an art centre in Cork, I was phoning him somewhere in England through my mobile phone and trying to explain to him the vision that we had for this event, which wasn't just a normal Ralph McTell performance concert, and he picked up on it, and if he'd not run with it, we would not be here this evening. So special thanks to Donna 1 year ago. Maybe before that it began, though, that was when the Arts Education Research Grouping got together and started our interest in biography and arts biography and why that should be so. And that happened a little bit before that time. But then when I thought about it, and actually my fascination with the thing about artistic biography really goes back to my own youth, all those years ago, when I first went to a Ralph McTell concert, like explaining to people that the first time I was ever allowed out on my own as a teenager was a Ralph McTell concert. What happened on that night, I won't tell you now, but there were several events during that night which entered into kind of our own family history. Curiously enough, I mean, Ralph, I mean, we've been talking about like parallel lives. I mean, you know, I've seen Ralph many times over the years, and this is what really got our interest going, really, in the way that, you know, we relate to artists, writers, singers, people that we perhaps never ever meet, but somehow we resonate with. There are things that they carry in their work that form part of our own biology, our own thinking, maybe sometimes even our own artistic output. And these are the sorts of things that we've been exploring with Rolf in what we're going to offer you this evening. Even before that, when I look back at it, in my own memory, I have a very distant memory of the very first. I remember it in England on a Sunday evening. There used to be Sunday half hour after. It was kind of like, you know, not quite religious, but something that was related to something reflective. And there, as a kind of 14, 15-year-old, I first got captivated by, I heard this song, Streets of London, Mrs. Adlam's Angels, Dad is Here. You're going to hear these this evening. And it formed very much part of my own kind of musical, artistic awakening. But also awakening into the world of adulthood, if you like. And you know, these sorts of memories and these traces that remain with us all our lives are very much what we're about in exploring artistic biography. That's what we're about today. It's, as I say, we're interested in, you know, what makes writers, artists, musicians, who they are, their influences, how they kind of distill all these interests, why they end up producing the kind of work they do. We're doing that within an educational setting. We're interested, of course, in that, in terms of taking it into schools and students. We're working with students at the moment in performance pedagogy. I was just saying to Rita, this evening itself is an example of performance pedagogy, what it is to put on a performance. How do you teach this to students and pupils? It's very important to our mission, really. you are going to see, as I say, a very different sort of evening. This is not a Ralph McTell performance. This is Ralph McTell in conversation. There will be no break. And so please stay with it. And Marita, now I will pass over to bring on Ralph himself. Thank you.
So ladies and gentlemen, you're welcome again. And maybe just to say that there are a couple of layers in this project, one that Mike has outlined for you there. I suppose the second one from my point of view that I'll be weaving in tonight as a teacher is my interest in how we learn music. I think it's lamentable that so many of us start off learning music and drop out by, you know, fall out by the wayside, and we find that although we've got quite high ability on an instrument, we don't tend to stay with it for life. So I suppose I'm really just looking at the research in the last 100 years, which is all around how we teach music, and there are loads of methodologies and all the rest of it. In spite of that, we still have casualties. So we're looking now at how artists such as Ralph McTell learned to be a musician, in the hope that that will inform us in how we teach the students of the future. And hopefully, throughout this project, we get some idea of the kind of music that is important for youngsters growing up, and music that is meaningful, and music that will enhance their lives in turn. So it's my great pleasure, it has been over the last 2 days, having Ralph and his family here, to converse with Ralph a little bit more tonight, in front of you all, in front of the live audience. And so without further ado, can we put our hands together, please, and welcome our guests this evening.
I just love the road and I love what I do, and if anything I'm enjoying it more now than any time, I think, you know.
How many dates do you have in this journey?
Well, this is very near the end. I have another big concert in London on the 8th of December, and we're quite near the end now, so 31 weeks altogether.
Oh my goodness, in the last two months?
Yes, that's right, yeah.
Thank you so much for coming here.
Right, it's been my pleasure.
Fitting us in. And I believe I heard through the grapevine today that the venue in London is full, it's already sold out. Yeah.
On the edge of a breakthrough.
Absolutely. So you know what, you're phenomenally popular. Do you ever kind of fear losing the magic?
I think you do every night you walk out with your guitar, you wonder if it might all leave you this particular night, you know? And yeah. I think that gives you an edge, and you have a respect for what you're trying to do and the fact that people have turned up, and you just hope, and it's all part of the magic when it works, you know? Mm. Yeah, it is for me anyway.
Yeah, I know you've written recently about sort of the relationship between the audience and the artist, something that isn't quite published yet, but maybe just to ask you, are there particular venues that you prefer over others? I mean, you've played in the Royal Festival Hall, you've sold out the Albert Hall, and you've played in small pubs in Cornwall and Croydon.
I must say that the folk club thing sort of was a bit daunting for me, I'll be honest with you, when you can see everybody as beautiful as you all are. Sometimes it's nice to sort of turn the place, make it dark, and you're always in the same room wherever you play. I quite like that now. But so the smaller venues where you could see everybody were a little bit daunting, but I that's where I did all my early stuff, you know, in folk clubs and pubs. There was a wonderful vibrant music scene in England in the 60s and early 70s. And probably still is, it's just that I've moved on from that now. And I've moved into colleges and then I did the concert halls. And I must say that there's nowhere quite like playing, you know, a big concert, because it's sort of, that's again another sort of celebration. But I don't really discriminate. Every night's the Royal Albert Hall for me, and it is tonight.
And how do you sort of bring the freshness to the performance night after night?
Well,
is there a formula? How do you do that?
I don't think there's a formula, really. I think that if a song's worth repeating, then, you know, maybe you look for something else to say about it, you know, before you introduce it. You try to bring people into your world and the way you think about things, and or perhaps even what inspired it, or what two chords came together to make it happen. And I found over the years I actually am able to talk more about the songs, because if somebody had asked me when I started what I was trying to do, I wouldn't have been able to actually answer. I'm probably trying to play the guitar better, which I still am, and I'll write better. But actually, now that I've had a look back at it, it's easier to say, oh, that's what that song is about, and that's what I was trying to say, and some of them have managed to lose a lot.
So the whole reflection thing kind of adds a new dimension to the song.
Interesting, isn't it?
So could we go back a little bit, maybe? I mean, you've written two volumes of autobiography.
Yeah.
You've written Angel Laughter and followed up then with Summer Lightning.
Mm-hmm.
And you really chronicle what it was like growing up and the development of your musicianship from the age, well, as far back as you can remember, a year and a half, to about 23,
yeah,
with great detail focused on the early years.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about what it was like growing up in Croydon.
Well, I was born in the end of 44, so I was an end of war baby, and like everywhere, it was tough. It was very, very hard. A lot of poverty, a lot of people with nowhere to live, and very poor housing, so food was on the ration, and relationships, sadly, amongst people returning soldiers, didn't last very long often.
Mm-hmm.
So, but through all that old cliche about poverty bringing people together, there was an honesty amongst people that is sadly missing, I think, today, or has changed.
Yeah.
We were all perfect, because
yes,
we certainly weren't, but there was something there. There was some sort of bond, everybody seemed to, well, perhaps more in it together than they are now, at the moment. But it was an incredibly rich childhood for me, because it was largely unsupervised, because my dad left early, and that was that. So my mum had to go out to work, because there weren't the sort of benefits that there are now. So she did everything from charring and working in a shop and minding the kids or whatever she could do, and meant that my brother and I had the freedom of the car-less streets to run and roam, and roller skates and all the rest of it, and we had a remarkably free and unfettered childhood. It was amazing.
And it's amazing in your biographies as well, you know, you detail the people that you lived with, and the people that, I mean, it was a very social type of life, even though there wasn't very much economically.
Mm-hmm.
You had a richness, really, in the people that were around you.
Very definitely,
and they're all larger than life, and you describe them in great detail.
I suppose I try to, when I was writing that more, I'm immensely grateful for them, because the people that, coloured our lives, maybe I have glossed over some of their foibles and everything, but it was great. You know, the kids were almost common property in the street. If somebody needed an errand, they'd call one of the kids over.
Mm-hmm.
Until they, that was all right for me until I joined the Wolf Cubs, and I handed the penny back for running an errand one day, and the word went round that I did it for nothing. So I was always being called to go down the shops, because I wouldn't charge, because it was my good deed for the day. But, you know, errand sharing and trying to earn a bit of money on your own, you know, my brother and I, collected newspapers and stuff and sold them down at the scrapyard and like that. So, yeah, we found a way, and we got pocket money that enabled us to go to, we got 6 months a week, which enabled us to go to Saturday morning pictures, which filled our minds with games and visions for the following week, which was tremendous, you know.
So, there were happy days, really, in the fact that...
They were happy. They were kind of precarious, too, because...
Yes.
A single mum bringing up two lads, it's not the easiest job in the world, and I think we were good kids when I look back on it, but it was hard for her, and obviously lonely and tough, you know, so there were hard times, but I think we were very respectful, my brother and I. We could have been a lot worse, in fact, and so we were sometimes a little bit insecure, but...
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that I don't know if you put it in the book, but it was amazing. My old mum, she was, and she is still with us. She's 96, by the way. She lives adjacent to our world somewhere, you know.
Yes.
But she'd been in service as a girl, you know, for rich families and even minor royalty at one point. And she'd acquired this idea of reading stories to us, and we got read to, and that was a very, very precious and important time. Of course, and then you had radio, where you had to envisage, you know, the stories and put your own pictures in your mind. So that was good as well, and part of an enriching job.
So there were opportunities for developing your imagination then, you know, yes. In the sense that you had the stories, you had the movies on Saturday.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So what about the music then? Did you fall out of your mother a musician, you know?
Well, I think Mum used to sing occasionally, which was very confusing. If she was singing, we thought, well, she's happy. She used to sing a song called I Wonder Who's Kissing Her Now. I always wondered, surely that should be I Wonder Who's Kissing Him Now, because of my dad.
Yes.
I mean, I thought she'd made it up, sort of thing. You know? And those songs, those lovely kind of melancholic post-war early songs, you know, went into my consciousness, and I like that, and I would sing a little bit. I joined a choir when I was a kid. I almost organised my own religion as a little boy. You know, I was quite a believer, I must say, for a long time. And I got a lot of comfort from it. But music, really, I think every little boy in the 50s had a harmonica, mouth organ.
Yes, yes.
And I was no exception. I got one from Father Christmas one year, a plastic one, and I learned to play Hot Cross Buns on it. And then my ambition was to buy a shiny silver one, which I eventually managed to do.
Yeah.
And it was always in my pocket, and then I learned to whistle as well. So, and then my grandfather gave me a one-string fiddle made out of a cigar box and half a broom pole.
Yeah.
It didn't put a string on it. I had to save up for 1 and 6 to get a guitar string to put on it, and almost hairless bow, and I nearly drove the family mad with that. But it was part of the exploration, how notes change, and the further up you go, the higher and so on. And you know, you're absorbing all that stuff.
Yes, and this was going on with Bruce, your brother in the house. Did he ever take up the harmonica and play it?
No, it's very funny. He's not tonally very accurate. And it seems that that's the way it goes in families, isn't it? I mean,
yeah.
I think they say if you have two musical parents, then your children will be musical.
Yes.
If they're not musical, then none of your children will. But if one is and one isn't, you'll have a sort of divide. So I guess, I don't know if that's really true, because apparently my mum said my dad was always whistling tunes, but Bruce not.
And funny, your mum did say to you one time, I was reading it in your biography, she said you whistle like your dad.
Yeah, she did. Yeah,
so
I was very pleased.
Yeah,
with that.
You know. So your mum was a singer, your dad was a whistler, and then your grandpa also played, didn't he?
Apparently so. Her grandparents played, the melodeon, and my granny, my great-granny, that would have been played concertina, apparently.
Yes.
So they would have been hymns. They would have been hymns.
Can you remember, Ralph, was there music in school?
Yes, but I didn't get it. I didn't get the singing in school, I have to say. I don't know why. We were compelled to do country dancing, which ought to have been enough to put me on folk music for life. But we pranced around the room, jigged about and so on, and I suppose that was my introduction to that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
But no, I didn't really respond. And anything vaguely formal which involved any kind of mathematics was an anathema to me. Couldn't cope. I'm an ear musician, but I did persuade, after months, maybe years of nagging, to get a piano. I did get an £8 10 shilling piano in the house, which I loved.
And did you take lessons on the piano?
I was about to. I think I might have done two, and it was 2 and 6 at the time, and it wasn't going in. I was memorising what the lady was saying. So I couldn't really, in good conscience, let Mum pay the 2 and 6. So.
But she actually did set up lessons for
you. Well, she was.
Yeah. So music in school wasn't really appealing, and then the piano lessons weren't really appealing either. Yet you found yourself joining choirs and singing choir music when you were very young.
Yeah, I did. I still find the corporate act of people singing together one of the most moving things. The surrender of the individual voice to the greater cause, if you like, and that we've got this wonderful series of programs with amateur choirs on the TV at the moment, and I sit there on the sofa with a box of Kleenex here, you know, breathing at the sound.
Yes.
It's wonderful and very enriching. Yeah.
Yes. And as you said yourself, that whole spiritual aspect of your early childhood was quite important to you, wasn't it? I mean, Sunday school and all of that. You know?
I needed something else to hang on to, yes, very definitely. And that helped, yeah.
Yeah. So your name then, Ralph May.
Yes.
You were called after? Was it a grandpa?
Well, my mum says that my dad had once, I thought he'd like the music of a composer in England called Ralph Vaughan Williams. Ralph is the
yes.
posh word for Ralph, actually. Yeah, so, and I was quite touched that my dad, who was an ordinary working class bloke, would have liked Ralph Vaughan Williams. And then my mum said, no, I think he just worked in the garden one time and he thought Ralph was a good name and that's why you were called Ralph, so that's it.
Yes. So there is another connection musically there.
Yeah, I suppose so.
Yeah, and I suppose the other thing that struck me about your book was that from a very young age you were a performer. You know, we were talking about performing earlier in audiences. I mean, you like to do magic tricks.
Oh, I love that. And puppet shows. I when the kids say they're bored to that, I don't get that because I was never, ever bored. And I very seldom am now. I used to make things out of cardboard and stuff, and you know what I'd seen at the pictures that we had made swords, bows and arrows, you know, all that sort of thing. But I would make inventions. I always wanted a television. I wanted to be allowed to listen to Radio Luxembourg, and a lady gave me a radio that I managed to wire up and plug into the lamp. I used to sit there in the dark in this condemned room. There was a condemned room in the house that we stayed in. We weren't supposed to live in there, but I had a candle on the thing, and I used to try and listen to Radio Luxembourg until the thing heated up so much it filled the room with smoke, and then I had to turn it off. And then it would cool down later on. But again, it was all part of it.
Yeah, yeah. And you made up your own stories.
Pardon?
You made up your own stories.
Oh, I did. Yes, mm-hmm. My poor brother was the victim of the stories of Piggy and Goat. Yes, and they used to. Yes, they were usually conducted in the toilet when we were both made to go to the toilet together. And I would amuse using my telling them, making up these stories. I still enjoy doing that with my grandchildren.
What kind of a woman was your mother?
Oh, she's amazing, really. I mean, tough, strong, very strong, with a very strong sense of right and wrong. Firm, very strict,
yes.
Tough, had to be.
Yes.
Frugal. I wish that the arts had meant more to her. I wish she'd got more out of what was available. Well, I wish that she'd had wider horizons than just. She used to read detective stories, and only to find out who did it. You know what I mean? Let's get rid of all the scenery descriptions and get to the. And that's the way she really was.
Yes, yes.
I think she was pleased with the fact that my brother and I both achieved things in a different way.
Yes.
But the old school, shall we say that, she's the old school. You're not supposed to touch or praise kids, are you?
Yeah.
Otherwise they get spoiled.
Yes, 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 so she's a disciplinarian.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. And your dad then, what's he like?
I can only draw conclusions from what I hear. He was he had a very tough time with his dad. He ran away and joined the army at 15, and his dad got him out, and then he joined up again after he met my mum at 17, and then that was in 1936 or so, and then he was sent out to Ethiopia, and he was at war, when war broke out, and then he went right through the war as a desert rat and so on and so on. But he was a bit of a naughty boy, apparently. He was prone to getting into trouble. And he made sergeant and got busted down to zero again. And I think he did a little bit of porridge at some time, you know, just a little bit now and then. But I don't know, when I look back, I think some of these fellas' war experiences were just dire, and how they didn't have the kind of counselling and stuff they get now.
Yes,
I'm looking for excuses now. As a kid, I couldn't really forgive him for what had happened because it had made the family unhappy. But as you get older, you get a bit wiser, you see a bit of a broader picture, and I have a little more compassion for him now.
So he came back after the war and joined your family and then stayed for a short time, is that right?
Well, he married at the end of the war, and then they went to send them out to Anzio for the landings in Italy. And I think at that point he decided he'd had 7 years and he went on walkabout. But they got him and they banged him up like they do, you know. And then he got out, and then whatever happened between him and my mum happened, and they parted. And he used to come back from time to time. My mum, I think she thought that maybe things would get back on the firm, but they never did. And,
so you didn't have very much contact with him then?
I remember him trying to show me how to bowl a cricket ball once, and I hope no one would be insulted when I say I still throw like a girl. I'm a great big bloke, but I can't throw a ball. My little lads could throw a ball much further than me. And I never got hold of that sort of hand-to-eye coordination thing, and I do blame him for that. I think I'm
So your mum really was on her own, bringing up two boys, very much on her own, and without very much money.
Yes.
But yet you say in the book that they were halcyon days, they were great days.
We were unsupervised, you see. We had a sense of what was right and wrong.
Yeah.
I mean, when mum was at work, before we could even tell the time, she would stick two bits of paper on the clock, said, when the big hand's on that one and the little hand's on that one, you can have your sandwiches, you know.
And you would wait.
And we would sit there and wait for the hand. And we also got orange juice from the state to help us. Cottage Royal and orange juice was from the state. And so we'd have a little bottle of orange juice as well. That was our lunch during the lockdown.
Yeah. And tell us about your mum in the woods.
Well, you know, it's hard for people to realise that the winter of 47 was one of the coldest ever, and there was one fire in these. We had three rooms, and two others which were condemned and boarded up, and the walls were wet, you know, you could touch them and they'd be wet. So we had one fireplace, and there were, to economise, Mum had put three house bricks in there, so there was a tiny little fire. So to supplement a bit of coal, we used to go wooden. Which was with a pram, and the neighbourhood kids would go up to this local bit of woodland, and at the end of the games, Nima would just call out and say, right, come on in, fill the fire up, and the kids would all come with bits of wood. And
so all this adventure, and then you came home with all the food for the fire as well. Very enterprising offering.
It was really. It didn't make much warmth, but it was a comfort to see it glowing.
So you've written many songs about this time in your life, Ralph, and then with the biography as well. Did you learn anything new about these people in your early years, about your parents, about yourself, from writing the biography?
I think I did. I think I learned an awful lot. The most significant thing for me was when my father actually got killed, when I was about 12, and I hadn't realised that, but I really now think that was responsible for my total academic failure, going from doing quite well at school to not doing very well at all, in fact, leaving and then joining the army myself at 15 to get out of danger and trouble, you know.
So with you, you were in school and you were a bright boy, you were promoted, you passed your 11 plus,
you
went into John Ruskin's school.
Mm-hmm.
So you had a real strong sense of belonging in the earlier years, yet when you went into that school, privileged stream, all the rest of your pre-university stream, something went wrong. And you think it might have been your father?
I'm quite convinced it was. Now, I must say that, you know, it sounds pathetic now, but, you know, the list of things you had to buy to go to grammar school, you needed a cap, a jacket, two shirts, shorts, gym shoes, boots. My mum was on about £5 a week, so I hid the list from her for ages. And then we found someone that we'd get second-hand stuff and stuff. It's horrendous. I mean, the amount of money that people were expected to come up with, and no consideration for their circumstances. So I've always been very class conscious, I must be honest. It's a flaw, but I think the British have got several classes that aren't clearly defined. There's upper and lower working class for a start. So I was upper working class. And there's lower and lower middle class and upper middle class and so on and so on. So I was very aware of privilege and very well aware of people who had money when we didn't. I must say I didn't resent it, but I was very much aware of it.
Had you an expectation academically of you?
I don't think so. Just for keep, you know, what's a single mum want most of all is to keep her boys out of trouble, I think, you know.
Yeah.
And the post-war period in England was a very dodgy period. There was hard-bitten soldiers home from the war. Some of them went into the police force, some of them got jobs in industry, but then there was the forerunner to teddy boys was something called Kosh Boys, which was sort of the mugging in the street and danger, and, you know, the headlines were full of it. Capital punishment was still being done and so on, and it was a I think all mums hopeful was that the kids would grow up straight, you know.
Yes, yeah. So she wasn't surprised when you came home one day and said, I'm leaving the school, even though it was a privilege to get into that school.
I think she was, you know, probably exhausted by it, yeah, you know, and yeah, she said, oh, well, that'll do, and the family all went, oh, that kind of sorted out.
Yeah,
know,
yeah. That sense of belonging, you know, in school is so important for kids. Was there music in that school? I was wondering.
Well, I had my harmonica, and you see, the skiffle period had begun, and I was fascinated, not in the kind of rebellious sense, but the music was starting to talk to me, and I loved the sound of the acoustic guitar. I bought a ukulele, actually. Well, I didn't buy one. I swapped it for a harmonica and got into trouble because the boy's mum said the ukulele was worth more than the harmonica.
Which probably is true.
And we formed a little skiffle group out of ukuleles and washboard, and we did one concert, which was a success at the school Christmas do. And then really, apart from a little bit of dabbling with a very, very poor quality guitar that should have put me off and made me take up trombone, I think, I didn't really pay much attention until much later.
So in that school, was there provision for people who are interested in music, in the sense, was music taught? Was there
was.
Yeah. And there was an orchestra?
There was a sort
so
of
band
orchestra.
Or
there was a choir.
Choir, yeah. But you didn't actually feel in any way drawn to it?
No, there was one lad that used to go into the music room and play the piano by ear, and I used to creep in there and just listen to him and just wish one day that I would be able to do that. You know, some kids are blessed, aren't they? He could just vamp away and play anything, you know.
Yes, yeah. I wonder, I'm just wondering from the teacher point of view, what it was that was missing from this music? I mean, something that it didn't attract you. What were you looking for?
Truth in music, I think, the kind of basic, so that's why rock and roll had so much appeal. It was no rule, was it? It was like, you know, you've got to move to it, and then you might suddenly notice what the guitar was doing. Or how the lead singer looked or something, you know, it had a much bigger appeal. It was a whole package, you know, it was sexy, I guess.
Yes, yeah. So you felt the music wasn't really relevant to your life?
No, I'd stuck with the choir for a while, but it wasn't what I was really looking for. Although I have to say that as a little boy, I was deeply moved by our wonderful hymn tunes. Mm-hmm. We have lovely hymn tunes, I think, you know, and they played properly, or, you know, and I remember we used to have to come into Jesus, Joy of Man's Desire in assembly and so on. And I thought I got it.
And you held on to it?
I held
on
to it.
And you used it?
I did, actually.
Indeed,
eventually.
You were artistic output.
Yes, I did, actually.
Much later, yeah. Interesting that. But I think it's nearly time for a song now, Ralph.
Okay.
And I thought maybe if you took us through some of the songs that were informed by the people or the memories you have of your early childhood.
Right. Well, when I made my first record, I was already married and had a son. And where my contemporaries might have been writing love songs about their latest girlfriend or falling apart or anything, I sort of scouted around for other things to write about, and there were. You know, it was the growing of this sort of social consciousness, I think, if you could put it that way, with Bob Dylan and people like that. And so my subject matter was a little bit different to theirs. And the first thing I wrote was, well, not the first, but one of the early songs was about what it was like when my dad went. So this is called Daddy's Here. Steps downstairs and at the door, pausing in the hall and at the door, 'cause I know the dad is here. I can tell that he's there. That means she'll be glad until we're in bed and she's alone. There are things that they have to say, and we are sent away. your skin, and I am too, and you're nothing. How could we know you don't need to walk to a neighbor's for a quiet talk? Sunshine's dying flicker on gray stone walls. Outside in the hall, the old dog growls. And we're in bed, playing guessing games. Telling stories, making plans. Radio, Saturday, and Sunday tea. It is nicer here, just us three. And I know that he won't come again. There is no need to explain.
How you got from avoiding school music to playing this song, to composing the song, to composing the poetry. You know, we're going to come back to that in a second,
yeah.
You know. Maybe first of all, we will hear a song about a character from your childhood.
Yeah, well, you know, I at one point, I was so in need, if you like, that I used to go to three churches on a Sunday. You know, that was my need, and I'd sort of created, I was raised just at Church of England, I suppose. But my mum used to like to go to church where they sang jolly songs, jolly hymns and everything. She went there for a while. So I used to go to I felt sorry for a bloke who was preaching outside our school one day, and he told us about this place. I went there, and I was already going to another Sunday school, and I went to another one. So I used to do three on Sundays for a bit, until I got totally exhausted. But there was one lovely old lady. You know, sometimes I am still envious of people faith, because I don't actually have that with me anymore. I have other things that guide me. But her name was Mrs. Adlam, and she held Sunday school at Mintwalk Mission, the Tin Cathedral of Croydon. And this is a song I wrote about her. Sundays as a rule, been a sea from dawn right through till the day begun. And we used to lie awake just to try and see one. And though we never saw one anyway, we thought we heard them sing in the air. Some days, occasionally, we were invited back for tea. Bread with jam and cream made Sundays seem a dream. In the dingy mission hall, Mrs. Adlon prayed, and down the street back home, all our mates were playing with Mrs. Adlon's angels everywhere. And we thought we saw a halo in her head. On Sundays for sure, ain't like that anymore. It's getting hard for me to see her face in front of me. I wonder if her angels have their arms around her clothes, keeping safe from life and guarding her from the world. On a summer Sunday evening, do I dare hear Mrs. Adams' angels in the air?
Painted on parchments that say into the
sail on, taking their castles and their kettles with roses, with the songs of childhood leaving smiles on the land.
Create new works of art, and in this tune, I give you a little reference to classical music. As a music teacher, I wish that came from school.
Yeah.
What do I hear there?
Well, you hear a bit of Greek, don't
yes,
you?
Yes, I do. Yeah. I do. Yes.
Well, that's an absolute.
Heard about it at school.
Well, I probably did, but also, you know, what the lovely coincidence is that it's called morning, isn't it?
Yes.
Well, that's what it is, isn't it? It's
yes.
About awakening. It's about beginnings, you know. So that was just coincidence.
So
like,
where did you hear this music?
Oh, I probably heard it on the, well, we probably the radio, maybe even at school, I don't know, maybe at assembly, but nobody said, you must yes. listen to this.
Yes.
You know, we're like sponges, aren't we? We just soak it all up, I guess. I must have heard it somewhere. But I didn't do it consciously. It's just a happy coincidence, Mr. Grieger. I'll spit the copyright for it.
There's a further coincidence that, another happy coincidence in that, one of your songs and also one piece of music by Grieg, this particular one, are on the Junior Cert music course in Ireland at the moment. Yes. So they're sitting beside each other happily in the textbook.
Wonderful.
Interesting, isn't it, when you're playing it, you know? And then you mentioned Bach earlier, Jesu Joy, and again you used that in one of your other songs.
Yes.
It's interesting. So I suppose what's fascinating for us at this stage is we know about your background is how on earth you went from the boy that was running on the streets, you know, unsupervised,
yeah.
to the man who can play the guitar, who can sing, who can create music, you know. So maybe we could look at this segment at the teachers. I mean, while you went to school locally, your influences obviously were more eclectic than that,
mm-hmm.
you know, and your teachers weren't the teachers in your school. So where did you learn how to do this?
I had a friend. I think we learned from our contemporaries, don't we? I had a friend whose brother liked jazz. When I was 11, I first heard Dixieland jazz, and I got it. You know, when I say I got it, it didn't puzzle me. It made all perfect sense.
Yes.
He said, listen, first of all, you can hear the tune.
Yeah.
This is the tune. Now listen, the clarinet's doing something different, and he didn't have to go any further than that, because I took such delight in hearing that the clarinet line was nothing like the trombone line.
Yeah.
And yet it all made sense. So you could listen to the whole apparent jumble of sounds, but then pick out things and then I would try to improvise a little bit, sing along, and just found that once you knew the tune, you could hit fine notes and so on. You know?
Yes, yeah.
Unfortunately, my brother and I went carol singing. I had to play the harmonica, and it was a bit hit and miss, actually.
Yes.
I tried to signal to go up higher with my eyebrows whilst playing the harmonica and things like
your
that.
Your brother
you know,
to go high.
For him to
you
go up
high,
yeah, yeah.
Yes,
to,
yeah, yeah.
Offer the instruction, but it...
Yeah.
It wasn't a great success.
So the music really came from your contemporaries, really. The music that was
I think so.
You
were turned on by
yeah.
your mates, aren't you? I think that's
yeah.
what happened with me. I was turned
yes.
on by my friends. And then I enjoyed that for a long while. And Lonnie Donegan was, of course, in the Chris
yes.
Barber band. And he went on to form Skiffle Brutes. And, of course, that was an interest which I've touched on before. But it wasn't until after my very brief and undistinguished military career, which lasted about 6 months, that I went back to college to try and resume some studies, and I heard some music there that was definitely to change my whole life.
Tell us about that.
Well, it was at the end of an evening at jazz club. I joined the jazz club, and in the hope that one day I would perhaps learn to jive and dance with some of the pretty girls. I never did. I've never really felt the need to express myself through the medium of dance. Although it was a medium. But at the end of the evening, somebody put on a record by a guy called Jack Elliott, who was a travelling companion, I later found out, to the great Woody Guthrie, the great American folk poet and songwriter. And there was something about the way he had played the guitar and the way he sang, and it was just sort of both hillbilly, and yet there was something else there. There was some other knowledge, some deeper knowledge, and I just had to have it. And I learned to play, I'd got the guitar out, figured out how to play some of the chords he was using just by ear, you know what I mean?
Yes, yes.
I never knew about capos, I didn't know about harmonica harnesses, but
yes,
it was that sort of raw American sound that I wanted.
Yeah.
And then I finally caught up with Woody himself, and I actually wrote to Woody Guthrie a few times. And I say in my book, we became sort of pen friends for a while, although he never actually wrote back to me. So it's nice to think that he was reading my letters. You know. And of course, Woody combined everything. Here was a man of conviction about the working people, ordinary people, writing accessible songs that you could play with two or three chords. You didn't need to have you know, great musical knowledge to be able to do it. How have I got this time with you? I'm sitting on a wall, I mean, obviously I fell in love with Woody Guthrie's songs, and they had kind of leftward leanings, but they were really about fairness and decency and respect for the ordinary guy, you know?
Yes,
and,
yeah.
And they had some sort of credibility, and I started playing those, and then I met a guy. You'd hear about a guitar player at the road who could play fingerstyle, or somebody that could play banjo, and you'd go and see them. And I formed a little duo, and by the time I was 17, I was playing at a little club in Croydon on every other Sunday or something, and it went from there, really.
So kind of from your pals, you were introduced to Jack Elliott, Jack Elliott to Woody Guthrie. So the journey kind of began like
Indeed. That.
Yeah, absolutely. So Woody Guthrie was hugely inspirational where you were concerned, and where many, many other musicians were concerned. Bob Dylan, I suppose, being
one of the ones we
think about, you know. And so Woody seemed to give you your voice, didn't he? He spoke about local things, and suddenly you felt that confidence then too.
I did, because I was singing the words written by a much wiser and a much older man, and they worked for him, and why wouldn't they work for me? And they seemed to reflect the way I was feeling at that time, and still am to a large extent. I'm a little surprised, having read as much as I could about Woody, at some of an apparent naivete to believe that things were going to change, given the place that he was actually performing the songs, but that he has been a guide in my life, and there's no doubt. I've done a few songs, I've recorded a few, and I still love them.
Would you like to sing one for us?
I'll try a bit.
Please.
This is a song which I think your very own Christy Morris has recorded. Certainly Christy and I, when I met him in England back in the God knows when, we were both big Woody Guthrie fans. This is a song about the migrant workers that, I won't play it all, I'll play a bit to just give you a reminder, that used to come across from Mexico to work in the big orchards in California. And one time they were flying them back after they'd done the season back to Mexico, and the plane crashed. And the radio announcer said they were just deportees. And this incensed Woody to write this beautiful song. The crops are all in and the peaches are rotting. The oranges are stacked in their creosote dumps. They're flying them back to the Mexican border to pay all their wages to fly back again. My father's own father, he waded that river, took all the money he made in his life. And my brothers and sisters working your fruit trees, and they rode on the trucks till they took down and died. Goodbye to my warm, goodbye Rosalita. Adios, Jesus amigo, Jesus, de Maria. And you won't have a name when you ride the big airplane, and all they will call you will be
cold fire over the last guy's skin, like a fireball of lightning that shook all our heels. Who are all these friends all scattered like dry leaves? The radio says they are just deportees. Goodbye. Say my reader, and you won't have a name when you ride the building, and all I will call you will be the old tunes. All I will call you will be the old tunes.
Spoke so directly.
Very much so. Yeah.
You know, I mean, he sort of, he got the message across. It wasn't complicated, and I think it was you told me that Woody said, somebody told me, I think it might have been you, Ralph, that Woody said if there were more than three chords in a song, they were showing off. There was no need for any more than that.
He used the struggle, I know. Apparently, I read somewhere that he actually got a letter congratulating him the first time he managed to play a D7th.
It's amazing, it just shows us you don't need an awful lot of music, really, to make your point. But for him, it seemed to me that the music was the means to a kind of a social justice awareness end, you know?
That's the way I took it.
Yeah, whereas then when you went off on your other track from him to the Mississippi, to the Delta, to the blues, you found something quite different there.
Yeah, I have to say that Woody was responsible for probably introducing me to Sonny Terry and therefore Brown and McGee, who were a most wonderful duo that I saw several times when I came to England a couple of times. But also the work of the ragtime guitar players like Blind Boy Fuller, who played with Sonny Terry. And somebody said, well, if you like Blind Boy Fuller, you wait till you hear Blind Arthur Blake. All these musicians triumphing over dreadful adversity, mostly black. Mostly blind and all dead at the time when I was listening to them.
Yes.
So I couldn't see what they were doing, but I was so intrigued by the fantastic guitar playing, and still am. I'm still trying to use what I've learned from those musicians. The Delta, the Mississippi Delta, another unique voice where they use slide guitar, very African, I think.
Yes.
That's, whereas the PA bond pickers, they are from a certain area. They've got a kind of, they've turned the guitar almost into a piano, and it's a wonderful skill and very enviable way to play the guitar.
Could we hear a little bit of that?
I'm going to try. I'm a little nervous. I don't know. I hope this will work out. This is a song that Arthur Blake must have heard from Jimmy Rogers, who did the version of this. It was in a film recently called Brother, Where Art Thou? But Arthur's version is a little bit more primitive, but see what you think. Remember last election, I remember last election, everybody was in action, trying to get our man for president. There was a man called Lawson, from New York down to Boston, representing all the colored people we got there. My brother was a voter, also a great promoter, just giving folks advice. Get down to the polls and vote, that is what he wrote. But instead of voting once, he voted twice. He's in the jailhouse now. He's in the jailhouse now. No one will go his bail, so they let that man in jail. Oh Lord, he's in the jail. Now, well, I went out last Friday with a great big girl named Lily. She said I was the cutest thing in town. She started to call me honey. I started out spending my money. We went into the cave.
face, her loudest pain was out of place. She's in the jailhouse in love.
It's a complicated story, but I was invited by the great Wiz Jones, one of our legendary folk blues players in England, to join him while he was waiting for his partner to come and play banjo with him. And I was invited to a magical part of England called Cornwall. And some people would say, it's not even England, it's Cornwall. And I went down with Wiz, and we did very well together. In fact, we were sacked from the job because they couldn't. It's hard to believe, there was no PA, but they couldn't get any more people in, and the landlord couldn't cope, so we were fired, so that was that. We were too popular, it would seem. So then Wiz found this little place, a deserted barn, where they had a folk club, and he suggested that we made some posters, and I thought Wiz Jones and Ralph May sounds more like solicitors almost. Too short, so I thought maybe a double-syllable surname would be better, and I had been learning and been playing a song by Blind William McTell called States for a Blues, which I'd sort of made my little signature tune. So we decided that would do. So when I got my record contract, I did ask the record label if I could go back to Mayhem, and oh no, McTell is much better.
So you're happy with that?
He's I'm very happy, that. I answered to both.
Very good, that took quite a little bit of practice, didn't it, that last piece?
Oh yes, I didn't play it as smoothly as I have. I play it best on my sofa at home, actually. It's like everybody plays their guitar best at home. But, it's just been such a labour of love, you know, learning to play, even getting close to those masters, you know, of the guitar. So I still enjoy that. Still.
And what's the process? Is it sort of putting it on, slowing down the
record? Well, not anymore. I couldn't
then,
know.
Way back.
Yes, it
then,
was then.
That's how you do it.
I left a trail of ruined albums belonging to friends, you know, where I'd be lifting them. The arm on and off for the young members of the audience. That's how we used to listen to music. how is he doing that? And somebody said, what you do is you actually play, instead of playing at 33, play it at 16 or whatever the slowest speed was, and you can actually hear the sequence of notes. But I think because rather like those wonderful musicians who couldn't see what the people they were learning from, to learn by ear has actually created, I think, kind of, you know, from in these islands, or a unique way of playing that we've taken back to America and shown that we can do different things with the guitar. And there is an identifiable style, I think, that comes from here.
And that all came as part of a kind of coterie of like-minded people.
Yes, absolutely.
Just
sat
around together and made music together.
Some people actually wrote down the chords, and I just tried to sort of watch what people were doing and to try it out when I got home, you know. But mostly it was just sitting down and. And if you play a lot, if you do what we call noodling, you know, you do have these little accidents at hand that remind, oh, that's that thing in so-and-so, because where can you go? I mean, there's an infinite number of combinations, but the discovery, the guitar reveals its secrets if you keep playing it, you know.
Yes. Nice way of putting it, yeah. There's another legend you speak about in your book called Joseph Spence.
Joseph.
In what way did Joseph inspire you?
Well, I think he was a combination of Mrs. Adlam in his simple, direct beliefs and Blind Arthur Blake. But he came from an island called Arno in the Bahamas. And he'd learned to play the guitar in an old English tuning way, and he played everything in one key. But he never ran out of ideas.
Yes.
And the songs the improvisations and everything. Everything in one key, and it's bewildering and exciting, and not everybody's taste, but I found him quite inspirational. I wrote a song that I played. Well, this man, by the way, was a carpenter, as well as a stonemason and a fisherman, and he played guitar, and remarkably, when he died, he still had all the fingers on both hands. So I thought, well, I'm going to make a dedication to these wonderful... He didn't really sing much, he kind of grunted in time for the music, which was also a delight. So this is about Joseph's hands. Joseph's hands, it says in the hands of the carpenter, there began their powerful and their strong. Oh, they're the hands that you're working on, they're the hands that you work along the way. Now Joseph, he did all of them things, but he also learned how to play. He would sing about joy, sing about faith that the people wish they had. Now he heard the voice of Jesus when the road had he got mad. He's a bold and harbor and he's safe in that love. He knows someday he'll be sailing above. When they looked to Joseph's hands, they said that the hands of the stonemason were they bringing. Sing about things people wish they had. Now he heard the voice of Jesus when a rolling sea got mad. He's a boat in that harbor and he's safe in that love. He knows someday he'll be sailing in love.
So you're a young man, you're pressing your guitar, you're singing a bit with your friends. What are you getting from the English folk scene at the time? What was that like?
Well, not all of it appealed, I must say, the endless ballads and so on, and the long, very long introductions to songs, but there were enough great guitar players out there that I would be quite happy to just watch. Martin Carthy, in particular, I think one of our national treasures, found tunings on the guitar to make strange voices on the instrument. David Graham, the great David Graham, who fused acoustic music, folk music with jazz, and was an amazing innovator.
Yeah.
And somewhere between the two, if we add poetry as a medium, we must have Bud Jones. These were the guys that I'm delighted to say I got to know. All three of them are friends. And sadly, we've lost Bud and we've lost Davey, but Martin continues to never be tired of the job and still inventive and creating wonderful stuff.
And yet, it was an interesting time, I suppose. I mean, you were a post-war baby, and then suddenly, like, you're growing up in the 60s, kind of, all the excitement and that. And just when, I suppose, the UK, the British people, are looking for a Bob Dylan, an English Bob Dylan, Bob is now huge, following Guthrie's steps,
yes.
You decided to up and go, to leave England and go abroad.
They didn't ask me to be that man, you
yeah.
know. No, I mean, I loved the idea of the road. I mean, I was an apprentice beatnik at about 16. You know, I joined a coach with very knowledgeable boys who were much older than me, aged at least 18, who would talk at length about, you know, the poetry of Allen Ginsberg and Jack Kerouac, and I just was, you know, a dog, and the music that went with it, West Coast. American jazz, which was fast and furious and bewildering, but I knew there must be something in there of the knowledge, the truth that we were looking for. So I just could, and then we had no money. We had to get this established. There was no money. So people would just get on, if they could play guitar, would just leave, get enough money to get across the channel, and hitchhike, sometimes down to the grape fields and pick grapes, or mostly just to be traveling. That was it.
Yes.
People say, oh, I'm having a year off to go travelling now. They've got two credit cards and a mobile phone. Well, I had a 10-bob note folded up in my little secret pocket in my jeans when I left, and I had a 10-bob note folded up in my little jeans pocket when I come home, and I took the guitar, slept by the side of the road, and, you know, had my adventures, and, you know, it was fabulous.
Did you enjoy busking?
No. I was far too nervous. I'm sure the front row, you can see how nervous I am. But, you know, we discovered quite early on that the best place to play is where they can't get away from you. So standing on the street corner is, you know, if anybody's planning it, I don't advise it. I think the best place is to play to outside restaurants or cinema queue. So that's what we used to do. And we got by.
So you went off to Europe and you travelled right around Europe, Spain, Turkey, right over as far as Greece, and you had some interesting adventures while you were there. And maybe I'll come back to that in a second. But first of all, I suppose when we were working on this project over the last few months, year possibly, we were looking at your songs, and we were looking at the voice of Ralph McTell emerging from the two traditions, you know, from on the one side the Mississippi blues, and on the other the kind of the English guitarists you mentioned earlier who were an influence on you. And as well as that, I suppose, the huge influence of the early years. And we felt that the characters in your song took on lives of their own. Some of them were real characters that you're remembering, others were ones that were imagined, but were as real as the real characters, and we dealt with that whole aspect of memory, inspiration, creativity. So maybe we could look at now just some of the characters immortalized in your songs.
Right.
So let's see, where do we begin? I mean, there's so many sort of categories of character and all the rest of it, you know? What do we decide to do next? The fragile characters.
Yeah.
And again, the influence of Woody Guthrie, you know, you gave a voice to these marginal characters.
Yes.
You know,
well,
so
that's,
Michael.
That's, I hope so. I mean, that probably wasn't my clear intention at the time, but it's got something to do with fellow feeling, hasn't it?
You know,
you see something. I wrote a song about a girl in a dance competition who failed, and it was sort of viewed as sort of tragic comic, and I was happy with that because I didn't want to be too serious. But this song, Michael, has probably engendered as much or more correspondence as any other song I've ever written, because they always begin the letter by saying, "We have our own Michael."
Yes.
So shall I play that?
We'd love to hear that.
Song, been wrong, so wrong.
bring him to it?
Well, my wife won't mind me saying this. She had a very severely disabled brother called Ula. And she was describing him to me and saying, you know, he'll look at a piece of colored glass and he'll hold it up to the light and he's so happy with that. Or a piece of string, he'll make knots and look at them, and he's endlessly entertained by this. And I sort of wonder what he was seeing. What could he see that we couldn't? And I know he needed care and protection, and some of these people, obviously they do need care and protection, but it's, in a way, they have a freedom in here that we don't always glimpse. So that was the idea of the song. And people have been kind enough to say or observe that it's sort of it describes something like the symptoms of autism, although I never knew the word at all at the time. It was really for Ula that I wrote.
It's an interesting setting in the sense of the words are so tender, red, and yet you play it with this kind of, this protest almost,
sort of anger,
that we don't actually get it, we draw conclusions too soon. But
I think that was the idea in my naivete, possibly, but that was the idea.
I know you're getting tired now, but...
No, I'm not. I'm loving it. I'm having a great time, you know, you're making me feel really good. I stopped crying, I'm on the way.
I was going to ask you to do something a little different. I was going to ask you, I love a song you wrote called Naomi, mm-hmm. where you kind of celebrate old love, mm-hmm. the love between your aunt and your uncle Bert, I think, was it?
Yeah. Great uncle.
Would you read it for us?
Well, I will.
Give
yourself
a little rest. Have you got enough light?
I have. Thank you. Okay. I had to give a speech for the Dubliners Award of the BBC recently, and I came out with about 19 sheets of paper. And they said, "You're not going to read all that, lot, are you?" I said, "There's only 4 words to the page." I wouldn't put my reading glasses on. So anyway. This is called Naomi, and it was inspired by Naomi. It's not her song, but it's a sort of pretty name, and I wrote this song, which I'm delighted to say Morgan tells me he played it at some point a few years back. Play it again. It begins. Age has made her frail. I'm scared to take her in my arms. But there's an understanding now, and a peace behind the eyes. And age is for complaining, but you won't hear much from me. I'm growing old. With Naomi. Now I recall the first time I took her in my arms, and times I was unfaithful. She said, "No future in the past, so we don't talk about it." She keeps a gentle edge on me, and I don't mind growing old with Naomi. She wasn't all I wanted, she's all I'll ever need. Don't the rich men always want for more? And I was rich indeed, a rich man and a poor fool. Yet it turned out right for me. How lucky can you get, growing old with Naomi? Now kids today, they think that they discovered everything. But me and her, we done it all. Didn't need a wedding ring. And sometimes things remind us, and she's smiling back at me. It ain't hard, growing old with Naomi. She wasn't all I wanted, but she's all I'll ever need. A rich man and a poor fool. And I was rich indeed. I never thought her beautiful, but I do now. For I see, I'm getting wiser, growing old, with Naomi. The place is kind of quiet now, the kids have all left home. We'd like to see more of them, but we're grateful when they come. And in the quietness afterwards, she comes and sits by me. She makes me feel like a man, growing old with Naomi.
When I heard that song first, I wanted to be Naomi, and I thought the most wonderful thing that could ever happen to me is that anybody would celebrate Naomi number one. Maybe growing old, number two. You know, so Naomi must be very happy to have a song like that.
Oh, she never knew, bless her. She never knew that. But the beautiful thing is that, you know, 1 year just for a program idea, we said, has anybody named a little girl Naomi after this song? And we had about 30 little girls.
Of course,
Naomi. So
yes,
that was a nice one.
I'm not surprised. So I suppose what's interesting for me as well is the fact that you choose some people to write songs about. And I mean, how did that inspiration come?
Well, shall I? This is the explanation I've been given on stage. It's a bit complicated, but I'd like to share it with you. I was talking to a friend of mine who plays blues guitar, and a lot of blues guitar players, once you've learned your few riffs, you just want to fill up every space with notes. Mm-hmm. And the wise old black blues guys knew the value of pause and the eloquence of silence between notes. And that's something that I realized was in this song. I started with the last verse, the silence in the house after the family had gone. And the fact that one of them might have gone to the other one, just about say, well, state the obvious perhaps, isn't it, quiet now, they're all gone, but then just look, and then you don't need to say anything. And that silence,
yes,
is so eloquent because it sums up a life spent with somebody else. So I started there. By the time I'd finished the song going backwards, it wasn't Burton and his song at all, but it was somebody's. So that's how it goes.
Excellent. Okay, very good. You've written lots of songs for people in your family, for your wife Nana, for your children and that. Would you like to sing us a song that you composed to Nana a long time ago?
Yes, yes. Yeah. I forgot that's where we were.
Especially since Nana's in the audience somewhere tonight.
Streets to watch you laughing and stop still in the spring night rain. It's just to watch you smile again. Understand, I hold your hand a little tight, as if by this I'll stop the light from running to moonlight too soon.
he was willing to share things.
And Gary was American, wasn't he?
American.
I suppose in more ways than one, as I said, Paris was very good to you, so you met Gary, you met Nana, and also there was the big hit.
Well, yes. I started, you know, when you live on the street, if you're living rough, and I had been living rough quite by choice, you know, Woody had given the inspiration to go out and do whatever it took, but take a pride in it and do it as well as you can. And I was living on the street almost, but I had somewhere to sleep at night. There were people in Paris that used to sleep over the hot air gratings from the metro. And I had the beginnings of an idea of a song. And I was going to show you something, actually, because this is a bit of a folk song. Why don't I just play something, and I'll bring it into the song we're talking about. It was like this. Good old colony days, when we lived under the king, with a miller and a weaver and a little tailor, three jolly rolls of them. So it's this bit. If you play it slow, you get this. So it's just a line in the song, you know, and I was sitting down thinking, as soon as you hear those chords, you know the song, it would play it itself. And so I wrote this song, I began to write a song called The Streets of Paris, and I started to think, no, that's not right. And I suddenly remembered back to dear old Croydon again, an old guy that used to walk through the marketplace after the market closed down, just kicking through the vegetables and stuff, and every now and then Ben Allen picks them up at these parkies. And so he became the first verse, and then the rest of the verses sort of followed. Will I play? And you can sing if you want. Seen the order in the closed down market, kicking up the papers with his worn out shoes. In his eyes, you see no pride, and a loose at his side. Yesterday's paper telling yesterday's news. So how can you tell me you're lonely? And you say for you that the sun don't shine. Let me take you by the hand and lead you through the streets of London. I'll show you something to make you change your mind.
Say for you that the sun don't shine. Let me take you by the hand and lead you through the streets of London, and I'll show you something. Will you change your mind?
Shoot up.
It was stuck in his pocket, where it made him feel more like a man. He was out on the roof of the bottom of the darkest store, and somebody so damn dead. In a matter of minutes, where the police had arrived, when they saw them, you can bet them boys were scared. Cause Craig, he shouted that he had a gun, and he thought about the movies that he'd seen. Station, they signed the rifles out and arrived very quick back on the scene. Some of the police had called onto the roof, and Derek Bentley knew that he could not escape. So he gave himself up and they put him on. And he begged his young friend Chris, won't you do the same? Yeah, he begged his young friend Chris, won't you do the same? Yeah, give me that gun, the sergeant cried. Let him have it, Chris, poor Bentley said. But a shot rang out and it tore the night in half, and a poor policeman was lying there. A poor policeman was lying there. Oh, please, was lying there dead. Some said it was a bullet from Crane's gun that laid that policeman away. Some people said it was a police marksman's bullet, but some people said it might have been. Well, they were both found guilty of murder. Craig was too young, not yet a man. And though he was under arrest when the fatal shot was fired, Derek Bentley was judged old enough to hang. And on the 28th of January, in Wandsworth Prison, they took poor Derek Bentley's life. Some people shouted and some people prayed. Some people just bowed their heads and cried. Oh, you men on our behalf, who did sanction that boy's death? There is still one thing left you could do. You could pardon Derek Bentley, who never did take a life. Oh, Derek, he can never pardon you. Oh, Derek, he can never pardon. Scarcely of the ration, these two boys were not too well. These two boys were not too well. These two boys went out to rob a store.
And I suppose all the compassion that you picked up from that circle of friends, family, you know, as a young boy growing up in Croydon. Just since you have the guitar tuned like that, I might ask you also to play a piece of music that was influenced by our own Sean O'Fallon. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I'm not an academic, but I love Irish literature. I love I think one of the things that attracts me to it so much to Ireland is the mix of literary, love of literature and love of music, the two things are together. Therefore poetry, and therefore lyrics, and so on. And I read, someone introduced me to Sean's work, and I just loved it. I read it like, it was a collection of short stories, I read them like a novel, and at the end I just, how has this writer had this effect on me? I can't tell you the details of any of the stories. It was a feeling I got after I finished.
Yeah.
And sometimes the skill of the short story writer, I would cite Steinbeck as well, has the same gift for me, that you know, you were reading about one person, but you're wondering about someone else that's been mentioned, and how is that achieved? And are there any songs that do that? So, without deliberately meaning to do that, I found this tune. Like, the tunes exist on the guitar, they're only waiting to creep out of there. You just have to put your hands in the right place and out they come, don't they? And I remember writing this, it was in a break in filming when I was doing a children's television show. I suddenly found this tune, and I was thinking about Ireland and the role of the big brother, and is, well, it's self-explanatory, okay?
Yes. it's interesting. You have sort of caught the zeitgeist of the moment. When did you write that song?
89, I think.
89. You could have written it, like, you know, for current times. It is the sadness of those left behind.
I think that's the thing, isn't it? Those who wait, those who are left.
And also in the song, you've sort of captured the spirit of our music in the sense that you have the melody going on in the guitar while you're singing, melody being a very important part of our music, and the drum.
I had a wonderful piper play on the record as well. Tom Kane from Open Door, played.
Excellent, beautiful.
That gives you the chills when it comes in.
Yeah, for sure. So I suppose maybe to finish this segment, where we're talking about the characters in your song and the biographies of the stories of the lives of the characters in your song, you do have a facility to sort of, you know, catch the ordinary and make it extraordinary. And you know, we found that in quite a few of your songs, but there were two we mentioned. We might just sing one of them now because of time constraints. And the two that I mentioned here, I think I had Lunar Lullaby and I'm Still in Dreams.
Accomplished in Dreams.
So we can do.
I can play that one. Tell me a minute to just say.
I'm not going to say you've forgotten the words Still in Dreams, so we can't do it.
I'll tell you a little bit about it while I do. My sister-in-law once said to me, we were talking about spring, and everybody feels good when it's springtime. Certainly, it lifts us up no end, especially after the winters we get. They seem to be grimmer these days. But anyway, she was saying that the thing that lifted her most was the first tree that comes out is the willow tree, and the tips of the willow come out just a little bit. And so someone, she's a little short sighted, or she can't see it, detailing quite as well as some. But she said it's like someone blew a green mist into the tree. And as soon as I saw it, I knew exactly what she meant. I said, I wish I'd said that. So I did the next best thing. I wrote it into this song. And so it's about beginnings. And it's two tunes, really. The first tune is supposed to represent that sort of musical box, sort of strange sound. Musical boxes are both nursery and soothing and can be sinister. This is somewhere, supposed to be somewhere in between in nostalgia for times past, which starts off the song. And then the song moves on to someone still half asleep coming downstairs and facing the morning, another beginning, and the floor of dreams being as thin as eggshells that you must tread carefully into the real world. So this is called Still in Dreams. This morning I am still in dreams of you and I, both young and spring. My step is cautious down to breakfast. The floor of dreams is eggshell thin. There is a green mist in the trees. The toast is burnt
to send the crumbs, the sound of bees hung in my head. And I am all fingers and thumbs. I've been sleeping now for hours. I cannot see to wake me up. Getting rain on in the shower, or fumbling with my coffee cup. Deep down I know I'm in the mist, and that really I'm not even trying, for I've always been like this. Whenever I've been flying,
did, you know, to draw men's wages, but he worked like a man, and he was very shy. And I always think, look for the one-line poem, they're the best, you know. And he said to me, we were working down this trench, throwing up earth, somewhere near Croydon, just on the outskirts. And I tried to draw him out a little bit, and I said to him, you know, Michael, this was very strange for you, man, you know, over here, big city and everything, from where you come from? And he said, he literally said, oh, she is a long way from Claire to here, like that. Yeah. And I would have said, it's a long way from here to Claire, because it's where we were. But, you know, that's poetry, isn't it? Because the thing that was nearest to him was home. And that stayed with me. I was in 1962, and I wrote the song in 1975, I think. And it just came to me one day. I remember Michael and that song. So I should just tell you that everyone in Ireland knows the wrong tune. I played it to a friend of mine called Noel Murphy, an Irish fellow, great mate of mine. And I said to him, he said, that's what I have, I've got a gig tonight, I'm going up to Coventry to play. I said, are you sure you have the tune? He said, oh yeah, I have it. So he played it in this club in Coventry. And that night, Finbar and Eddie Fury were in the audience. God love them, I love them. I think they're great guys. Anyway, they heard this tune and they said, oh, we'll do something with that. And they came home. They'd learnt it from Noel, who got it wrong. So when I come over here, I said, please, give me a verse and chorus to see if we agree. And maybe we'll, but this would be a good place to close, anyway. We'll close.
I think we might just do that, unfortunately.
So maybe you could sing that as well, but you'll have to give me a chance to sing my version.
I see white horses dance upon that Arthur. is a long way from Glenview. It's a long way from
sincerely for his input into our research.
I'm honoured.
Thank you.